Okay. Oh, what are we going to do? Are we going to play Inky Pinky Spider too? Inky Pinky Spider went up the water pipe. Down came the rain and washed the spider out. Out came the sunshine and washed away the rain. So Inky Pinky Spider went up the spider again. Isn't he a handsome little guy?
Mm-hmm. Those very blue handsome eyes.
Yes. I wish I could see them better. Yeah.
They're like really dark.
Oh, you may as well sit here for a little while. I sure wish he'd dance for you.
Yeah, oh, I'd like to see that too.
I would love you to see him dance. It's hilarious. And his whole body is shaking and he keeps turning. Are you going to go get your music and dance? Do you want to dance for David? Okay, let's dance. Oh, Susanna, why don't you cry for me? Go to Louisiana, I'm about to see. It rained all night the day I left. Dance, honey. It rained all night the day I left. The weather, it was dry. Watch. Oh, Susanna, why don't you cry for me? Going to Alabama, away from you and my name. It rained all night today, I left the weather, it was dry. Sun so hot, I chose to dance. Susanna, don't you cry. You see, I was trying to get him to use his feet, so now he's using his feet.
Yeah, he is.
He's not using his body as much.
Yeah.
I like that body part. Yeah, he was trying out, but I think that spoiled his other hip. It was beautiful.
But you know what?
And now my arms, I couldn't swim around, no. But John and I used to go over to the Confederation Pool. It was a beautiful big pool, not too far from us, and when we were still swimming, John was pretty good at swimming at the end. We did a lot of it down in Arizona.
You take the first one.
You should come. Bite. You should come and see this here, Janine.
What's that?
Our dessert.
Oh.
Our second dessert.
We like dessert around here.
She's having fun here, so but I think I have to put it on my plate and use a fork. Well, I don't.
I was just gonna bite it like an ice cream cone.
Jesse, do you want me to make tea?
No, I think I want to eat some more dessert.
I better get some serviettes here. I gotta tell what I got. Here's some serviettes. Well, I don't know.
Did you guys fill them with strawberries?
What's that? Strawberries and whipped cream.
Look.
Just in time.
And here's a plate for you.
Ooh. Does it taste like authentic Norwegian grout?
I've never had this before.
Oh.
I never had them filled up with good stuff.
Oh, okay.
Actually, it's my first time.
I used to just eat them. No, but I lost one plate. Have you both got a plate? Have you?
Yeah.
Jesse got a plate?
No, I don't have one yet.
You don't have a plate? No.
Oh, Janine, well, there's a plate. Oh, yeah, you got one. I have one here for Jessica.
Oh, you don't have your dessert yet?
Nope. I was just being patient. Thought I'd see if Kelsey would bring it or just drop it and eat it.
Exactly.
I don't know what happened to that one. All of a sudden we had one from 4 to 3. I don't know.
Yeah, there's enough.
You want more cream than usual?
I like the cream, but I think I'm going to hold off.
Do you need more, Grandma?
No, I really. Oh, okay.
Am I on your seat, Grandma?
No, that's nobody's seat.
Good, thanks, Grandma.
I don't know whether you're going to have a mess there.
Probably, yeah.
So what's this called?
Kremakaka.
Kremakaka.
Krem.
Krem.
Say krem.
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 Easier said than done.
Kremakaka.
I think I managed to have an English accent for any language I try.
Gee, I feel bad there's nobody to speak Norwegian with. Since my brother Granny left, I have nobody that can speak with me.
Isn't there anyone here, Grandma?
Well, there's a few Norwegians.
They know the odd word, but they can't sort of carry on conversation.
Not true Norwegian, though.
You're sure that I didn't want to, that you didn't want me to make tea?
Yeah, I'm good.
Okay. Mmm. Isn't that excellent?
Mm-hmm.
No, I never had them filled up like this.
Oh.
Hilma used to make them, but she just served them and we just ate them like...
Yeah, they said you can eat them plain.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
Mm.
That's
but I thought whipped cream and strawberries are good on anything.
That's what I'm going to do.
These are really good pulse, yeah.
See if Cheryl can pick up the... It's like a little waffle iron.
Yeah.
And they had them in Camrose, and I saw them when I was there last summer. It's funny now.
I can vouch for that too.
Kids don't even want to sleep together. And when we were kids, I remember sleeping five in the same bed crossways. When we had a lot, we had so much company because we had three sisters married and they had kids my age. I don't know how my parents did it, but they were probably happy to see them come because they'd all bring things, you know.
Yeah.
They were all had more than we had, and they'd help mom, and they had a great time. But to sleep, where did they put them all? I don't know. But I know five of us kids in the bunkhouse. It was a big bed. Dad made all the beds. We never had proper beds. And we'd sleep five beside each other, and he had a big bench. He had sturdy big benches, and they'd put one at our feet with something on it in case our feet stuck out, you know?
Were they hay, Grandma? No, right. They wouldn't have hay. They'd
straw,
have a mattress.
Straw mattresses?
Straw mattresses, yeah, or hay, whatever.
No, that'd be uncomfortable. We never had a mattress.
Yeah, that'd be really uncomfortable.
Oh, we never knew the difference.
Huh.
He says, don't eat too much because we're going to have lots of lutefisk.
Oh.
I don't like lutefisk.
Yeah.
What's lutefisk again, Grandma?
I'll have a lutefisk.
I think isn't that the official dish of Norway or something?
Oh, it's definitely. It's definitely a Norwegian. And it's used
like pickled fish or something.
Oh, it's special.
Something horrible.
Pickled gross.
Oh, it used to just smell so strong. Mm. But now it's better than it used to be. Mm. I used to just hate it when my folks, only at Christmas, they'd get a little bit of lutefisk. Had been, you know, how they used to entertain the boys over in London there, or England anyway. And she had been corresponded with, I suppose, maybe quite a few, I don't know. And there were two from Vegerville. One lived south of town, a real nice looking fellow. You know, I can't remember his name now. And then there was Alec Horsdown. And he was he was so loud. If you went to town, open your car door, you'd know if Alec was in town. A big, loud, squeaky noise. And he was, I hate to call anybody homely, but he kind of was. And here she'd got the names mixed up somehow. And she'd been corresponding, thinking it was this nice guy south of town, but it was Alex. And he finally wrote and told her to come over, and he'd like to marry her, you know. And she came over, and when Alec met her at the station, can you imagine? She was very disappointed. Yeah. But, you know, she did marry him, and they had a son and a daughter.
Mm.
And he was a very poor farmer, too. But she fit in there with Alex pretty good. She was quite a scream herself.
Huh. What did the kids look like?
Well, I saw one of the girls at the Gorsline, some relative of theirs, funeral last summer.
Mm.
Not too bad.
Mm.
She's a very big woman. No, they were good neighbors. But can you imagine all the time everybody thought it was such a hilarious thing?
And what about the guy that she actually fell in love with? He married, he lived like a couple miles down too, didn't he?
He never did marry, yeah. He never did marry.
Exactly, that's the saddest part of this story. Yeah. That's the worst part. I know. Poor guy. I know. His true love is like...
No, it was quite funny though.
He was beaten by a
homie. his eloquency.
But I can imagine how upset she was when she met the wrong guy.
Yeah, she cried, eh?
But what could she do? She's over here and she was from a... She didn't have much, you know, herself.
Enough to go home, obviously, yeah.
I don't know. Gordy's like that, too. My goodness. But I got to show you the one picture that I was pretty proud of.
Yeah, right. He gets to get out of the camera.
I got to show you this one picture. Oh, he had a whole bunch when I was...
Nuts, too.
Oh,
we went to Heritage Park, you know, and that little
That's a good picture.
Katie, she can talk me into anything. Mm-hmm. She had me on the Ferris wheel.
Don't be afraid, horses,
Grandma.
Yeah.
Don't be afraid, Grandma. I'll hold you. And I'd pretend I was scared, and she was just hanging on to me. And then she got me talked into coming on the carousel.
Oh,
I said, Katie can talk you into anything.
Aww.
But Grandpa was with us, and Jesse took us to Fort Edmonton, and Grandpa was back there. And I was even, you even had me in a wheelchair pushing.
I know.
Yeah, because I don't remember just why, after my back surgery or something?
Yeah, I think so.
For some reason I couldn't walk too far. And so Grandpa was behind back there looking at something, and I saw this pony, and I says, oh, I'd give anything to be in that saddle. I used to love riding. And the fellow standing in front of the horse there says, well, there's no reason why you can't be. And I says, oh, yes, there is. I'd never get up there. And he says, yes, we cater to the old folks.
Yes. And I was like, Grandma, I'm going to go buy a ticket.
And so. Jesse says, go for it, Grandma. And he goes and buys me a ticket.
Yeah, while Grandpa was in the bathroom. Yeah.
I don't know. And so they bring these steps, real heavy, heavy board steps. And so they help me, and I step up, and I slid into the saddle, and it felt wonderful. But then when Jesse took the steps to put them away, he dropped them on the horse in front of
me. And that horse, whoop!
She jumped sideways and then reared up.
And then Grandpa turned around the corner.
And Grandpa came. He wasn't very happy.
At all.
And you and the other guy were hanging on to the horse's head so he couldn't rear up anymore. Mm-hmm. And when I came to set up, Grandpa was there, hanging on. You know, if you hold
Did you
the
fall off or you just
nope.
stayed on?
Barely. Barely. It reared all the way up.
But
all the way up.
He didn't look very happy.
Oh, my
what
goodness.
What are you doing up there?
That's funny.
Yeah.
And that was the pony. I still had my ride.
Oh, yeah. After that.
Yeah.
And then we went the next year, too.
And then I fell.
And then you fell. She tripped on the
yeah,
on the step.
I remember that.
I went sprawling.
Yeah.
Well, there was a little board up, wasn't there?
Oh, they, yeah, they ended up making stairs, but they left an edge, like a 3-inch edge on it, so you couldn't even see it. I didn't even see it. I would have tripped
on
it, too.
They were hanging on to me most of the time, and when I see easy walking, I like to just be free.
Yeah, oh,
so
for
I
sure.
I let go, and I'm walking along, and here's this board sticking up, and I didn't see it.
Yeah. I didn't see either. Yeah.
Oh well. Anyway, we survived.
We brought some. We brought
I'm
some
sure I've told you. You know, I used to have those kids quite
we
a bit.
Some
Here's a story on David.
No,
Drysdale.
I better not tell
yeah.
it if I can't write
it's
it.
Like
yeah.
Tell us.
Yeah, tell us what? In case you don't get around to writing it.
I know what you mean, and it's like almost raw, but it's
He'll
not.
Kick it
yeah.
Me.
Yeah. Yeah, and then
well, anyway, I kept David and Donna quite a bit when Rose was ill, you know, dying with cancer. So Sylvia was free to go. And this day, David, how old would he be?
Really good.
Oh, they were little.
I've heard of people about taking bacon.
3 or so?
Really?
Just a little guy.
Yeah.
And he was in the bathroom.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And he called, Grandma, Grandma, come here, Grandma.
What is it, Campbell?
Come.
Yeah.
So I went to the door and I says, what's the matter, David? And he says, Grandma, can you shake it for me?
Oh.
Little guy. And I said, no, no, David. I says, David, you can shake it yourself, babe. And he says, yeah, Mom, my fingers are so ticky. I nearly died. Poor little kid. My fingers are ticky, he says. I guess he realized that when he took it out. And then Gamma, you shake it for me?
So you told David that lately?
Oh, I told him once. He says, I don't like that story. So I got him a wet cloth.
I
gave him a cloth to wash his hands, to dry his hands. I was going to start that.
Got trained by the girls.
When Dad grew up in Ashmont, he had this old, and he was old Ben, so Dad was little, and their neighbor was this old hermit, or bachelor, I guess, not a hermit.
Well,
bachelor.
No.
And Charlie Hamlin, and he had no family, no siblings. He was from England originally, but no kids.
And he pulled his chicken eggs through the Drysdale farm, and he always came at supper time. And he'd say, well, I've had my supper, but I'll have a cup of tea, and he sat down and ate a great big meal.
Big supper?
That was always, yeah. And he's
when
the
he
guy.
Came to get his eggs?
No, he was hauling his town eggs to town in a wagon.
Oh.
Yeah, and he'd always time it. So anyway, then he started to come to our place.
So then they get married, and then when we were little, Uncle Charlie always came up. Well, we called him Uncle, but he was just his old bachelor neighbor. And so he came and he stayed and stayed, and every summer he'd come out to Vegreville and stay on the farm with us.
As long as we'd have
him. He was this old guy, and he, oh, I remember like playing with him, and we'd dress him, and he was hunched right over, like he was... had a U shape, like hunched right over these big shoulders. Something was wrong with his spine, right?
I guess so.
And he'd come and Mom would be trying, Mom would say, like, go on, Dad, like, go to the fields.
Who needs coffee?
But he'd hang around the kitchen and he'd eat a lot.
And especially...
Look, Grandma.
No.
Just try it.
No, she has a good
back. Oh, she's doing good.
There you go. We're on top almost.
That's good enough.
Okay. That's the same way Eric was. He's like, yeah, I'm done. Just slows the controls down.
Yeah.
That's it.
Who's coming?
True.
Yeah.
Because you wouldn't want him to live if he was having those terrible headaches and his aneurysm could have broken and he had cancerous prostate and he'd had it for quite a few years and eventually it turns into something.
Grandpa Tut's got that too, I think.
Has he?
I think so.
Well, Uncle Ernie, it started off with prostate cancer. Prostate cancer, and next thing you know, it was quite a long time, and then it gets elsewhere.
I didn't know Grandpa had that. Drysdale.
Your grandpa here?
Yeah.
Oh yes, he had a cancerous prostate for a long time.
Mm.
Quite a while.
Mm.
And they always said they wouldn't do anything about it because something else would get him before that.
Yeah.
It was slow moving, but you never know.
Mm.
So, I think he was very fortunate. He drove his own car, had his driver's license, he stayed at home.
Yeah.
He was never invalided. Because he said a few times he knew it wasn't good. He says, boy, I hope I don't live to be an invalid. That's the last thing he wanted. His wish came true.
Yeah,
and
true.
He says, I don't know how long a man can live with this kind of a headache. So it was bad. Last couple of weeks it was really getting bad. So actually
quite a few, even before that, it seemed like quite a few times that I'd come and see him.
For a long time.
Yeah. It just seemed like it was right after that first one, eh?
Yeah. So actually I think he was wishing not to live like that. So I feel really good for John.
Yeah, me too.
Yeah, I would not have wished him to linger, but that doesn't mean to say you don't miss them like the very old Dickens, right? But for a long time, it wasn't real to me. I guess I wouldn't really want it to be real, so I'd be sitting here, I'd hear the door opening, and I could hear him coming in, and that went on for a long time, and at night, I'd have to go to the bathroom, so I'd sneak out of bed quietly like I used to, not to wake him. And I'd tiptoe out, get in there, and then the realization came, oh, he's not there.
That's
and that was hard. I think it's better once you really face the reality of it and work from there on.
Yeah,
I think that's much better. And at the last, he was getting so... he wanted to hold hands, so he'd be walking down, he'd want to hold hands, and at night I'd feel the covers moving, and he'd
cuddle.
Put my hand in his, and then he'd settle right down. He knew something was happening soon.
Yeah.
And I could just tell. Yeah. But death can be kind of beautiful in some ways, you know, take you out of all your misery, eh? Yeah. For a child or somebody younger, it's so terrible. And like Albert, when you have Lou Gehrig and one little thing after the other starts shutting down and crippling you up, I think that's terrible.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's weird coming into the city. I was kind of glad I did it in a way, and then I was kind of not glad that I didn't did too when I came into the city that one day to come and see him.
Yeah, you went and sat with him.
Yep. Yeah, he squeezed my hand. I talked to him for about, like,
he's still new
4 hours. Yeah.
Yeah, wasn't that nice that he knew you were there?
Mm-hmm.
That was the good thing about it. But it's strange how after this side was totally paralyzed, his face still looked good, didn't it?
It did, yeah.
You know, he just looked peaceful and...
Yeah.
But never any movement.
No.
I said, could you smile for me, John?
Mm-hmm.
No movement except...
squeeze the hand.
When they'd... squeeze your hand. And when the girls would swab his lips, you know, when they get kind of dry, he'd sort of move a little bit. His lips would move a bit.
Mm-hmm.
But...
did you guys have a chance to talk?
No, we couldn't talk. He was lying down here, and he was totally paralyzed already.
Hmm.
He couldn't move. No. So it was a good thing that he still could hear us, and Debbie was the one that explained everything to him. She's pretty good being a counselor and that, too, you know. She did it so nicely. She, that was the first day there. It was just Devin, Linda came. And she was holding his hand, and he kept squeezing it. And she told him exactly what had happened, that he'd had this massive stroke, and that he would not be with us very long. We didn't think he'd last more than the day. The doctor didn't.
Yeah, that's what Mom said.
And that he was going to be leaving as soon as work was done. And she told him so nicely that not to worry. They didn't want him to worry about us. We were, everybody was fine, and they'd look after Mom, except we were going to miss him terribly, and what a good daddy he'd been. And then big tears trickled down his face.
Mm-hmm.
Three times he had these big tears come down his face.
Yeah.
So, you know, he knew what we were saying.
Yeah. He was crying when me and Mom and Uncle, were there too.
Was he?
Yeah.
You could see tears.
Yeah.
Yeah, but his face didn't move.
No.
He couldn't move a muscle in his face. But isn't that strange, although he's so totally paralyzed, that his mind was enough
crisp,
to know to bring tears. That is so strange.
Yeah.
Hearing was good. His hearing was there. But there was more than hearing when it brings tears.
Yeah.
That's amazing, I thought. Yeah. Yeah, well, I'm glad you went in to see him, because felt real good about that. He said all three that were remaining Drysdales were all gone within a year. His kid sister, too, died not that long before they did.
Yeah. Everything happens for a reason, though.
You should see Uncle Simon.
Yeah?
In a beautiful power wheelchair.
Mm-hmm.
So Deanna and I said, well, let's go on out for a while. And so it was in a slow gear.
Mm-hmm.
Quite slow, but just like you'd walk, you know, slowly. And he says he'd like to get it a little faster than that, but I hope they don't. And, you know, then there's a walk that goes all the way around. Have you been to this place?
No, I haven't, to be honest. No.
Well, there's a wide walk going totally around the whole, and my, it seemed a long way. So anyway, we didn't realize it was that far, but we started out. And then the black clouds, it looked like it was going to start pouring. I was so afraid it was just going to come pelting down on us, and he couldn't make that thing go any faster.
He's just going slow, eh?
So he was sure going to get after them to make it go faster, but I'm sure they won't. Oh, it was quite amazing.
Mm-hmm.
I was surprised that they let this old man have a powered wheelchair in with so many poor people.
It's like that bugger downstairs who hit you.
Yeah.
That was It's pretty, you know.
He was an old, like, well, you see that fellow had Lou Gehrig.
Yeah.
And I think it was starting to affect him.
It's shaking, yeah, his hands were shaking.
Yeah. And yeah. He was wanting to swing it this way instead. I guess he pushed it
into you. Oh,
but did he ever feel bad?
Oh, I would too, though. He laid you right out, he said. He said
I was right flat, and they had a heck of a time getting me up. Oh, dear. Fine fellow.
And you and Grandpa met through your dad, right? Because your dad said something about the milkman?
Yeah, that was so funny.
He just said that? He just, was he hinting or?
No, but no? I went to Ashmont to my brother's wedding.
Mm-hmm.
And then I stayed for a while. Mom and Dad had just retired and moved into Ashmont, but they were kind of lonely. They sure didn't care much for us there either.
Huh.
So I just stayed for a while because Dad says the Chinaman here is looking for somebody. So I took the job.
In like a Chinese food place? Like Chinese food or?
Well, I didn't do the cooking. He cooked if there was anything to cook. He did it. Mm-hmm. But he had a little concession, a little confectionery store.
Yep.
Yeah. And anyway, then I didn't like it much out there. There was hardly anybody I knew. And Dad says, haven't you met the milkman yet? And I says, no. And he says, well, he's one of the nicest guys in town. I guess he had met him.
Mm-hmm.
It was really funny.
That's weird. Most people don't get introduced to their loved one from their dad.
No.
Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, I know. He had known him before they moved into town because Dad drove the mail to Ashmont, you know?
Yep.
Yeah. And I guess he had met Dad around town before they moved into town.
Hmm.
And I guess he was maybe friendly with the mailman, you know? Must have talked to him. Hmm. I don't know how Dad knew.
Hmm. Your dad farmed, right?
Pardon?
Your dad farmed, right?
My dad farmed?
Yep.
Yeah, but it was very poor farming.
Yeah, because that was bad land.
And very poor. And the last quite a few years, you know, he was an old man as long as I knew Dad, it seemed to me. Mm-hmm. And he wasn't all that well, so it was the boys mostly that did the work.
Mm-hmm. Was he sick?
The last few years, they were the ones that ran the mail route and everything.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So he was pretty sick?
Yeah, he had heart problems.
Oh, okay.
And he always carried his nitroglycerin.
Oh.
Yeah, and then he'd had pneumonia a couple of times.
Oh, jeez.
And he was very sick with pneumonia. We thought he was a goner for a while there. And he got over it, but it was the heart that took him at the last. He was 71.
Mm-hmm. That's a pretty long time, considering he had problems.
That was old.
Yeah.
But you see, he was, I don't know how old he was when I was born, because I never saw Dad as a well person.
Mm-hmm. What did you guys do for fun? What's, like, some of your good memories?
My good memories?
Like, with him, that is, I guess.
Well, with Dad, no, we never did much with Dad. He never played with us or anything, but he was very, very nice to us. He was a very good man.
Mm-hmm.
And I suppose my closest memories with Dad was once a year, we would get a trip to town with the mail.
Mm-hmm.
And imagine sitting in that buggy all the way, the big long day, the 12-hour drive.
Wow.
And then he'd always try to get into Ashmont in time to see the train.
Hmm.
And then, you know, just that trip with him, that was the big highlight of the year, was getting to town.
Really?
Isn't that something?
Yeah. Like, you had never been to town before?
Oh, I guess I'd been to Clavish, but, you know, we hardly ever got to town. And to get to see the train yet, you know, that was kind of special.
That's pretty cool.
Did she have her shower?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh.
I don't know if she missed. How about your mom, Grandma?
Hmm?
What's, like, some good memories you have with your mom?
With mom? Yeah, she was good. There was not a lot of playful stuff. It was mostly work and helping
spending
her,
time.
You know?
Yeah.
And she, at nights, I guess I have good memories, but at night, mom would, we had a very little place, you know. She'd be sitting spinning. My, she was good, though. she could spin, and you had to work your foot, and there's a wheel going, and we'd sit around carding the wool. You know how carders are?
Yep. Yeah, you take the little brush and...
Us kids would sit around carding wool, and then you'd push it back, and you'd have it in a little round ball,
mm-hmm.
about so long, and move around, and we'd lay them in boxes, and she'd grab one of those, and she'd start, why golly, this mm-hmm. thing is going... She made really nice yarn.
Mm.
Yeah, and then she'd take one bobbin off after she had sold another one, and then somehow she did the two together.
What do you mean?
So it was a two-ply wool.
Oh, double thick.
One ply. I don't know how she did it, but yeah. And then we'd have to take it off there and roll it into balls, and we were always helping her. And Dad would sit and crochet. He made a crochet hook out of willow branches.
Really?
It's easy to do, you know.
I suppose, yeah.
And he'd crochet sometimes from these little woolen balls that we made. He'd just sort of twist them. And he'd crochet like a mitt.
Yeah.
And you'd never get cold if you had one of those soft wool mitts, you know. And then he'd make a leather, they got some kind of a leather stuff, I don't know just what it was, and he'd sew outer mitt to
mm-hmm.
go over this, you know.
Yep.
Boy,
sewed, eh?
Went to the mail route in the coldest days, they said they could never get cold with those mitts.
What did you wear on your feet in the wintertime?
What?
What did you wear on your feet in the wintertime? Because you said you didn't have shoes in the summer.
Yeah, that's
no,
true.
No, well in the winter, Grandma would knit socks. She spun the wool, I don't know how she did it all. And then she would knit socks for us, real wool, that's pure wool, you know. And very often we had moccasins, you know. The Indians up north there, they were making moccasins, and they'd give you moccasins for meat or anything.
Mm-hmm.
We nearly always had soft moccasins that you lace them up, you know, cool. Mm-hmm. And then somehow we did have rubbers mostly, you know, little... You know,
still pretty cold because the days were colder back then too.
Garden.
The days were colder
cold.
Back then.
Well, it was cold.
Yeah.
Yeah. But we were just kind of warm.
Lots of chopping wood.
Yeah. Kind of different life to what it is now, isn't it?
Yeah, very different.
Yeah. But what you're going to have all kinds of wonderful memories when you grow up with your children.
My memory's terrible. I probably won't remember half.
You what?
That's for
I won't remember
that's
half.
For video
stuff.
Cameras coming to play.
Yeah. No, you
I just
started
videotaping myself at this point.
A little bio.
But I often think with so many kids in our place, we could have, if Mom and Dad weren't so strict. I love them to pieces. I really thought a lot of my Mom and Dad, and I still do, you know. I have no bad memories. But I do think that if we could have been allowed to play cards or something,
mm-hmm.
we could have done things, because there wasn't that much we could do in the winter evenings, you know.
What did you do?
Well, we helped Mom with carding wool half the time.
For fun?
We'd sit around, yeah. And, of course, we'd maybe have a bit of homework, but you just had those little old pull-on lamps and no place hardly to do homework.
Yeah.
I don't remember doing a lot of homework anyway.
But all your sisters and brothers, they ended up growing up and playing cards and that, right?
Oh, yeah.
Like, they didn't maintain those traditions?
Oh, well, some of them did.
Really?
Oh, yeah.
The older ones probably did.
Yeah. Rhodey, mm-hmm. the oldest one, because,
she wouldn't play cards or watch TV?
No,
or
they wouldn't play cards or dance or anything.
Really?
And Alfie was quite religious.
So was your mom disappointed when she found out you were playing cards and dancing with boys?
She didn't like it at all.
No?
No, she didn't like us to play cards or anything. But you know what? We respected her, and even after we were married and lived in the farm in Vegable,
mm-hmm.
and Mom would come out, I'd have her come out every once in a while. Mm-hmm. I'd always make the kids not bring the cards out when Mom was there.
Mm-hmm.
No, we never, never played cards in front of Mom.
Hmm.
Did you have dancing at your wedding?
Well, we had a wedding dance later on at Ashmont, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
But Mom wasn't there.
You didn't do it the same day back then?
No.
Mm-hmm.
How long was it again between your marriage and your time Grandpa got back? It's like months, wasn't it?
No, they come right after they got back.
10 days or 11 days, wasn't it?
Yeah, that's what it was.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, after he came back from the war.
How was that? He came back on the 14th. And we were married on the
25th. Wow.
Had to get everybody to come. That's quite a bit of work, getting in contact with everybody to come, I would assume.
Oh, well.
Probably wasn't a lot of people there.
It was mostly family. We didn't have a big
do.
Who sold your dress?
Pardon?
Who sold your dress?
Well, I bought one.
Oh, did you?
I had the dress.
From when?
From what?
Where did you buy it?
I don't remember, but in Edmonton here. Yeah, it was quite plain. Well, you can see on the
picture. I like it.
You were working at that doctor's at that time, right?
Well, I was working, actually. I started off working in the home, and that's mostly what I did. But I do a bit of work at helping him with some things.
Yep.
You know, and cleaning the office, and I'd work at the Red Cross with her some. They used to do a lot during the war, you know, a lot of volunteer work.
Yeah, I bet.
And she would take me along for that. And it was just kind of an old couple. And they had a beautiful big home. And they had only had one daughter, and they lost her when she was 5 years old.
Oh, is that ever sad?
So it was still Joan's room, and they treated me really good.
Mm. And you can't keep in touch with them?
Well, they died.
Oh.
Yeah, they're both gone now. And the house isn't there anymore. It's all part of the university grounds now.
Mm. Did you have a lot of people that were trying to date you when Grandpa was gone?
Well, I...
Did you have to scare away a lot of men?
Well, I did go out a little bit, but not a lot, no. Because I don't think Grandpa did.
Mm-hmm.
He was quite...
faithful?
Yeah, kind of jealous, too.
Isn't everyone, though, Grandpa? A little bit.
Yeah, he didn't like me.
But I think you were sure that Grandpa was alive.
Oh, I was sure, yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's right. Mm. But we'd go out a lot with the Luther League, the church group. And there was a lot of young people there. And we did a lot of things together.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Was it still taboo for women to drink back then?
To drink?
Yeah.
Oh, I never used to drink. And this group, they never drank. Mm-hmm. No. No, there wasn't as much drinking with, I'm sure there was, but there were more things I think you could do without drinking.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Because I remember going to the Silver Glade. Oh, gosh, we went there a lot. And it was a hall in the West End, right off 24th Street, north of Jasper Avenue quite a ways. And it was called the Silver Glade. They used it for a lot of other things. But they'd be roller skating.
Oh.
And beautiful music. You know, like the outdoor skating is so nice when you have nice music.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. We outdoor skated a lot, too. And, oh, gosh, I used to like that. I used to. And you get a good partner, you know, and you just, I used to love that. It's easier than ice skating.
Yeah.
You just keep moving and going.
Mm-hmm.
We did a lot of that, and there was never any drinking there.
Hmm.
And of course,
movies and stuff, eh?
Pardon?
Did you go to quite a few movies?
Yeah, we went to movies.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Mostly my girlfriends and I.
Did they have music? Like, did they have sound? When did sound come into the movies?
Oh, no, there was sound at these. Yeah.
Wasn't there silent movies? When did?
Yep.
Oh, when first Dad off. And I, the first time I had a date with Dad, the first date I ever had with Dad was to a silent black and white movie.
Really?
In the hall.
And then didn't you run into a guy that wanted to date you on the way?
Yeah. Not on the way. He came to the cafe. And Dad...
shut him down?
Well, that was terrible.
What was he doing?
All my life, Grandpa teased me about Reedy. he'd talk about old Reedy. That was my sister-in-law's brother.
Really?
Yeah.
How does that work?
Benny's wife.
Sister-in-law.
Helen's brother.
Mm.
Oh, okay.
And he got to know me at Benny and Helen's wedding. Yeah.
But he was quite a bit older, wasn't he?
Oh, yeah. He was older, and I didn't like him.
Hmm.
No. And I'm... it was hard to say, I guess, but I think I told him, no, I wasn't going to go to the movie or something. Because I know he had said something about it, and I think I... But he came anyway.
Mm-hmm. Tried to trump Grandpa.
The cafe, yeah, mm-hmm. And the first thing he says, well, I guess we better go. And I says, well, and Grandpa didn't know what to do.
Was Grandpa was mad, or...
No, the kid was mad. He called me a son of a gun.
No way.
He did.
Holy smokes.
I always remember that. It's just son of a gun.
Did you ever meet, did you ever have to talk to him after that?
I never talked about it. I didn't talk to him much, but I've seen him. Mm-hmm. I saw him more than once after that. Mm-hmm. At my brother's funeral and at the kid's wedding.
Okay. Well, I've got one a friend there has. And there was this little child that was born without an eyelid. And so they came up with the idea that when they circumcised the little fellow, they would take a bit of this skin and build him an eyelid. And it really worked very well. And when the doctor asked the mother if she was quite pleased with the results, she said yes, it is. But he does look a little cockeyed. I don't like that. Okay, there was this swim race across the English Channel with the breaststroke. And there was this Norwegian girl and an English girl and a Russian girl took part in this race. And the Russian girl came in first. And the English girl came in not too far behind. And they waited quite a long time before the Norwegian girl came in all puffed out. And they says, oh my, but what took you so long? And she says, well, I hate to complain, but them other girls, they use their arms. Well, there was Ole and Lena, and there was Sven and Olga, and there was Knut and Brita. And all the boys were killed in a car accident. And as they were on their way up the golden stairs, they met Peter. And St. Peter said, well, each one of you will have to answer a question, and you have to be honest. And so he called Ole first. And he says, Ole, have you ever been unfaithful to, have you ever had an affair with other women? And Ole says, oh no, I would never cheat on Lena, never. So St. Peter took his book out and he said, yes, you are telling the truth. You never did cheat on Lena. So there'll be a nice Rolls Royce for you up in heaven to drive around it. And then he called Sven and he says, Sven, did you ever cheat on Olga? Oh no, never, I don't cheat on Olga. Well, maybe once or twice I did. And St. Peter took his book out and he says, yes, I see you did cheat on Olga, but at least you did tell the truth. So there'll be a little old truck for you to drive around heaven in. Then he called Knut and he said, Knut, did you ever cheat on Brita? Oh, never, never. I would never cheat on Brita. So he took his book out, St. Peter took his book out, and he says, oh my goodness, but I see you did cheat on Brita, and you even lied to me. Now all you're going to have is a pair of roller skates to when you get to heaven. And a few days later, Knut and Sven
saw Ole leaning up against his Rolls Royce, and he was just crying bitterly. And they went up to him and they said, "Ole, Ole, we thought you'd be so happy up in heaven with your Rolls Royce." And Ole said, he was crying, and he said, "Well, y'all, but you saw Lena go by on roller skates." That's sad.
Okay, go.
Well, little Johnny just loved mice, and he was always playing with them. And this day he had one, and he shoved it in his pocket when he got to school. And then the little mouse ran out, got out of his pocket, and he ran down the floor and up the teacher's desk and up the teacher's leg. And she jumped up on the table when she saw it coming, and it ran right up her leg, and she was squished her knees together, and she squished the little mouse between her knees. And little Johnny ran. When he got home, he told his dad about his little mouse getting squished between the teacher's legs, and he says, "I never knew you could squeeze that much water out of a little mouse." Well, one day Ole had to fly from Edmonton to Montreal, and he was sitting beside a kind of a stuffy old Englishman. And he thought, well, if we're going to sit together so long, we may as well talk. So he said to the Englishman, "I say, where are you going, dear then?" And the Englishman, he just looked the other way. He was not answering him. And after a bit, Ole said again, "I say, where are you going, dear then?" And the Englishman, he does not answer him. And Ole's getting really determined. He wants to talk. And he said, "I say, where are you going, dear then?" And the Englishman turned to him and he says, "I don't answer questions that end in den." And then Ole, he's really getting quite perturbed. He's thinking. And after a bit, he says, "I say, where are you going there, den, you yakass?" Ole and Lena had now retired, and they built themselves a nice little cabin down by the river. And but Ole, every day Ole would go fishing, and Lena was really getting tired of that. She said, "Ole, Ole, why do you always go fishing? You know, sometimes I like you here for myself too." And Ole says, "Oh, Lena, you know how I like fishing. And why don't you get yourself some little pigs or chickens or something to take your mind off me all the time?" And next day he came back here in the backyard. She had a little pen, 6 chickens and 2 roosters. And Ole says, "Lena, Lena, you know one rooster could handle those chickens. You don't need 2 roosters." And she says, "Yeah, but what if one of them wants to go fishing?"
Okay,
Ole and Lena were sitting in the evening. They were sitting in their wheelchairs side by side, and they were tired. They had just celebrated their 55th anniversary, and they'd had well-wishers coming and going all day. And Ole, he reaches over and touches Lena's arm, and he says, "Lena, I'm proud of you." And Lena says, "What did you say, Ole?" Ole says, "Lena, I said, I'm proud of you." And Lena says, "Ole, you know I can't hear very well. Just speak up." And Ole, he spoke up loud. He says, "I said, I am proud of you, Lena." So Lena says, "Well, that's okay, Ole. I'm tired of you, too." Huh? Another time that Ollie was flying across the country, and he had had a very, his favorite food before he went, a nice bean supper. And as they were flying along, pretty soon this fellow sitting next to him turns to him and he says, "Hey, you let me gas us off here." And Ollie answers him and he says, "Well, yeah, sure. Surely you don't think I smell like this all the time." I think that's awful. Don't you?
And what?
Are you on?
Yep.
Well, one evening, Sven and Olga and Oli and Lena and some of their friends went to a party. And they were drinking quite a bit. And after a while, Oli couldn't see Lena. And he went looking for her. He thought maybe she was tired and went to rest in the car. So he went and he looked into his car. And here he saw Sven and Lena huddled up together in there and in Ollie's car. And Ollie went back in and he said to Sven, "Oh my goodness, but now Sven, he's so drunk he thinks he's me." Take it, but anyway, this lady was living alone, and she was kind of lonely, and she thought, "Well, boy, I'll go to the pet store and see if I can buy myself a pet." So she came home with this beautiful parrot, and as soon as she put the parrot down, the parrot says, "My name is Polly, and I'm a prostitute." And gee, she didn't like that, so she took her back to the pet shop, but they says, "No, we've got the money, you've got the bird, and that's the way it is, you know." So she took her home, and she was so upset, she phoned her priest, and she says, "What am I supposed to do? I don't think it's nice to keep this bird around here. Every time somebody comes in," she says, "I'm Polly, and I'm a prostitute." And he says, "You know, I've got two male parrots, I guess so, here, and they are the best birds ever. They say their rosaries, and they pray nearly all day long. And you bring them over, and I'm sure that they'll teach her." So anyway, she brought it over, and as soon as she got there, she put the bird down, and she says, "My name is Polly, and I'm a prostitute." And that's when they threw their beads and says, "Oh, thank you, God, our prayers have been answered." Isn't that stupid?